I will introduce Dr. Bill Colglazier. As Rush said, Bill has numerous hats. I think almost more hats than he had when in his previous jobs. But Bill is currently the editor-in-chief of our journal Science and Diplomacy, as well as a senior scholar within our Center for Science Diplomacy. But he's also currently a member of the technology facilitation mechanism of the United Nations, as charged with looking at the science and technology issues related to the Sustainable Development Goals. Bill has had a long and illustrious career that you could read about in the program, but most immediately before he joined AAAS, he was the Science and Technology Advisor to the U.S. Secretary of State. And before that, he had a long career at the National Academies, including serving as its executive officer. So, Bill, take it away.
I thought Tom was going to say I have more hats than hair, and that's a certain thing. No, we have a terrific panel today, and so I'm going to be very brief, because we've only got an hour, and I think all of them have, I think, very insightful things to say. A friend of mine who served on this UN advisory committee said that the UN's 2030 agenda and the Sustainable Development Goals are a great gift to the world. But they're also a great gift to the science and technology community, because one of the mandates when the countries of the 170-plus countries agreed on these 17 Sustainable Development Goals, which are aspirational, they're to apply for the next 14 years all the way to 2030, they also said that in order to have a chance of success in making progress, that the world is going to have to harness science, technology, and innovation more effectively in the past. So it's really a call for the science technology communities around the world to be involved in this process. And as Rush indicated, it's certainly true, I think, in the United States, the SDGs are not known at all by the public, and they're also very little known by the scientific community. So I think we have a challenge trying to raise the availability of these issues. The panelists here, you have their bios. I was going to say something very briefly about each one of them. First, we're going to lead off with Vaughan Turekian. Many of you know Vaughan. He and Tom actually were the creators of the Center for Science Diplomacy at AAAS and the journal Science and Diplomacy. So hope all of you read it. You have some of the paper copies. We don't produce very many. But the new online edition, paper copies yet to come, for the latest one is now available on the website. But Vaughan is the fifth Science and Technology Advisor to the Secretary of State, doing a number of creative things in that role, I think raising the visibility and the impact inside the State Department. The second person I'm going to ask to speak is Hana AlHashimi. She is a member of the permanent mission to the United Nations of the United Arab Emirates, the happiness representative, but also the advisor on sustainability issues. I had the privilege of going to a conference. It was in Dubai a month or so ago, where there was a very interesting focus. I was on the SDGs, and I was quite impressed with the effort that's going on in the UAE. The second speaker, Professor Tateo Arimoto, he is from the Graduate Research Institute of Policy Studies in Japan. Japan is taking a very active role, including the science and technology agencies in Japan, as well as the government, society in general, focusing on the role of science, technology, and innovation for the SDGs. The next will be Ambassador Román Macaya Hayes. He is a scientist. He's also the ambassador of Costa Rica to the United States. He gave, I think, a very excellent talk at a recent conference on science diplomacy at the University of Arizona. And the last speaker will be Jerry Miller. Jerry has had experience in OSDP, in NOAA. He's now the director of the Science and Technology for Sustainability Program at the National Academies of Science, Engineering, and Medicine here in Washington, which has a round table focusing on sustainability issues, a lot of focus on domestic issues in the United States, but also a number of studies that have looked at various aspects of these issues. I've asked each one of them to speak for maybe 5 to 7 minutes to open things up. They're free to say whatever they would like. I hope they talk a little bit about what, in the case of particularly those from outside the United States, what their country or their region is doing related to the SDGs. I think you'll find a lot of societies are taking it very seriously. If we're going to turn these aspirational goals into action, it really means that we're going to need plans that are societal plans occurring in countries and in regions, not only at the national level, but also at the subnational level. But we will start out with Vaughan. You heard that he is the co-chair of what is called the country co-chair with his colleague, the ambassador to the UN from Kenya on the role of science, technology, and innovation, the multi-stakeholder forum for achieving the SDGs. He was the co-chair for the first one, which was held last June, and the UN also asked him and his colleague, Ambassador Kamau, to co-chair the upcoming one, which will occur in the middle of May. So Vaughan will help to set the stage on these issues, and then we'll proceed with the other speakers. Hopefully we'll have some time for Q&A, and then I'll also give a few wrap-up minutes to each of the speakers. So Vaughan, you're up.
I'll just do it from
either there or turn next to Hana.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Turekian, for that great introduction and inspiration, I think. And thank you also for your leadership, along with Ambassador Kamau, in creating a forum really at the UN where we really bring different actors together to work towards the SDGs. Thanks also to the AAAS for the invitation to join you today. As mentioned, my name is Hana AlHashimi. I'm the happiness representative and expert on sustainable development at the UAE mission to the UN in New York. I'd like to take off perhaps where Dr. Turekian left off in saying that the Sustainable Development Goals were really a watershed moment for the UN. It's probably the most comprehensive development agreement that's ever been reached. And on top of that, it's legitimately developed and universally applicable. They also create a huge demand for humanitarian and development solutions, as well as monitoring and evaluation. And a great deal of those solutions, as said, is going to come from the science, technology, and innovation community. If the SDGs are the roadmap for the fourth industrial revolution, and if we're to take one lesson from the father of the third industrial revolution, that's Dr. Deming, then I'll quote, "In God we trust, all others must bring data," end quote. It's a clear case for science diplomacy. If I may speak about our national approach to policymaking in the UAE and to bridging the gap really between science communities and sort of evidence-based policymaking, the SDGs really resonated in the UAE, both domestically and as a major donor, because they closely mirror the way in which we've structured our own systems. Government policy and spending is driven by key performance indicators across every single sector, with underlying imperative that sustained, inclusive social and economic growth must be achieved while rapidly reducing the environmental footprint. For example, Vision 2021, which is the main national development vehicle, instructs agencies and state-owned companies to deliver an energy mix with 27% low carbon supply by 2021. This approach is overlaid by a focus, and some might say an obsession, on innovation, continually evaluating and integrating new ideas and technologies into our markets, especially to diversify away from oil. So the SDGs and the culture of measuring, reporting, and identifying challenges and solutions are a very natural fit. And even while SDG negotiations were going on, our Prime Minister's office were looking into how to ensure that our national KPIs are either aligned with or preferably exceed the SDGs. So we now have a federal national committee on the SDGs, which includes 14 line ministries and sets an institutional framework for advancing on them, with each ministry developing an engagement plan to consult with respective stakeholders in order to deliver on the SDGs assigned to them. For example, a subcommittee for SDG 3 on health, which was mentioned by Dr. Turekian, will be led in the UAE by the Ministry of Health and Prevention, who will be consulting with their local Emirate-level counterparts, academic and research institutions, and multilateral agencies such as the WHO, to deliver on targets for SDG 3. Similarly, ministries of energy, infrastructure, and environment will be tapping into their networks to help them go along. Perhaps one of the most interesting institutional developments was our cabinet reshuffle last year, in which the Prime Minister and Vice President presented a formula for national development based on core values, including tolerance, that's led by youth and focused on the future, focused on a future in which everyone achieves happiness. This vision coincided with the appointment of four new state ministers, a minister for tolerance, a 22-year-old minister for youth affairs, a minister for the future, and a minister for happiness, who I have the honor of representing in New York. A very unprecedented intervention, in short, to ensure that our development agenda is genuinely comprehensive. In terms of leveraging and building on SDI assets for the SDGs, you could say this is a central thrust of government implementation. The UAE's goal is to be well on the path towards a knowledge-based economy by our Golden Jubilee in 2021. So the instruction is not just to meet targets, but to meet them in a way that positions us for future industries and jobs. I may build on a few examples. We're looking to build a hyperloop to cut down a 90-minute commute between Abu Dhabi and Dubai to just 12 minutes. We've partnered with the Cleveland Clinic in order to bring world-class healthcare to the country. We've also set up a sustainability graduate program in university, which is Mustar Institute in collaboration with MIT, to provide a workforce that's trained in water, energy, and waste innovation, and drive local solutions to pressing problems. And we've created industry-leading telecommunications companies that are working on digitizing almost all government services. The same philosophy applies to our foreign aid. For example, Dubai Cares, our landmark education philanthropy, dedicated 10% of its budget to research and development on delivering education, especially to girls in humanitarian settings. In terms of policy, the National Innovation Strategy, coming back to this obsession of ours, was launched to embed a culture of innovation at the individual, organizational, and federal levels in priority sectors of renewable and clean energy, transportation, technology, education, health, water, and space. These are supported by an innovation-enabling environment that includes the launch of 11 incubators and building research and development capacities, as well as boosting investment in research and development by mandating that 1% of every government entity's budget be allocated to innovation every year. The strategy places a strong emphasis as well on developing human capital and attracting the best global talent. And accordingly, 60 to 70 chief innovation officers have been appointed throughout government. And they undergo a training program that really sort of develops an innovation mindset in order to promote a culture of innovation and entrepreneurship across all sectors. Another key component, especially relevant for this discussion, is the government backing of platforms for discussion on sustainability and innovation. It's almost every week that we get notes about conferences and workshops with amazing speakers and participants, which really reflects the government's intention to make the UAE a place where good ideas are heard early. Just three examples. There's Abu Dhabi Sustainability Week, which is the world's largest annual event on sustainable energy and water, with over 30,000 delegates, which also includes the big annual meeting of the International Renewable Energy Agency. The Global Manufacturing and Industrialization Summit, which is happening right now until tomorrow, which brings governments and technical communities together to shape the fourth industrial revolution towards the achievement of the Sustainable Development Goals. And the annual World Government Summit, which is the largest global platform dedicated to exploring the future of government driven by technological advances and evolving citizen expectations. If I may briefly expand on the summit, we were very fortunate to have the support of Professor Colglazier, as well as Dr. Turekian and Dr. Carrera Martinez in this year's summit, with the main activity being SDGs in Action, which is really a lab that brings together leaders, policymakers, academics, and key representatives from international organizations from around the world to look at key challenges to the implementation of the goals and to identify, most importantly, to identify potential solutions. This year, SDGs in Action focused on the role of science, technology, and innovation for the implementation of the goals, building on the success of the first SDI forum at the United Nations and continuing discussions in New York to identify solutions in Dubai. The two-day focus group session was led with the help of chief innovation officers, again building in this innovation mindset into an ideation process. And on the last day, focus groups pitched their ideas to earn votes from the broader group. The top ideas were selected and will be showcased at the upcoming SDI forum. So without giving too much away, we look forward to seeing you all there. And I'll stop here and look forward to hearing from fellow panelists. Thank you.
How to do? Excuse me, I need your help. change. Sorry. Sorry. Okay, thank you. Okay, yeah. Okay, thank you so much, dear Bill and the colleagues here. So, time is limited. So, I want to talk about 3 points from Japan's perspective. First, here, Japan's effort experiences in the last 50 years. As you see here, about 50 years ago, at the age of the high economic growth in Japan, there had been many areas, the air, water, and the food, land contaminations across Japan, not only the industry area, but also the in neighborhood, living neighborhood across Japan. Since that time, Japan's industries, as well as the governmental sectors, not only the central government, but also the local government, have been developing environmental technologies as well as the public policy tools and regulations. And the those technologies and regulations deployed in impacted areas. Therefore, the we can get the clean and the sustainable conditions across Japan now. So we can rebuild our society clean and sustainable and resilient through a combination of the technological innovation and social innovation based upon those efforts and spirits. Japan has now the ability to retain social stability and the cohesion under the changing world, even after the March 11th big earthquake and the Fukushima accident. And second, I'm going to tell you current activities by Japan's various sectors relevant to the SDGs. As far as the government, under the leadership of the Prime Minister Abe, SDG promotion headquarters at the cabinet was launched last May. The guideline for Japan's implementing of SDGs was announced last December, including 8 priority issues. One of the priorities, utilizing science and technology and innovations. I can say SDG is, Bill mentioned, a great gift for Japan's science community, not science community, but also the industrial community, to reform our traditional management ways and the innovation systems. And also the we can have the voice in the policy process by the scientific communities. Second one is the private sectors. Number of Japan's industries, such as manufacturing, food, chemical, pharmaceutical, and the trade industry are now growing interest with the SDG to change their visions and transform their organizational structures and business model. They also emphasize bridging domestic, national science and technology policy more with the SDGs, and they have just launched task force for detailed design of the SDGs at Japan's engineering societies, including the public-private partnership. So third one is the university. I can tell you the this time this is just example, Tokyo University case. So the Tokyo University, now the in process of creating university-wide new organization and the cross-disciplinary programs for better alignment of her missions with SDGs under the president of Tokyo University. And fourth one is the funding agency. This is very important player. So Japan has launched the science and technology research partnership for sustainable development, so-called the SATREPs, started 2008. SATREPs is a new major program to promote international joint research between Japan and developing countries for addressing global issues. And the and also the for enhancing the capacity building in developing countries. The program is a very unique combination, domestic the research funding agency and the official development aid structure, JICA, Japan International Cooperation Agency, joint funding programs. So so far the SATREPS program has been successfully developing the innovative systems, for example, to combat outbreak of infectious diseases in Africa using mobile phones, and to leverage biotechnology for boosting production of the prawns and other commercially important varieties of seafood. And the last one is the example is the to advance the refining technology for fostering next generation natural rubber industry. So my last point is the, okay. Here, it's very congested picture. So I show you here international landscape concerning the related organizations and systems with the SDGs in the global scientific enterprise. There are many diverse organizations, right-hand side the United Nations, left-hand side in international science communities, and the ICUSU, International Social Science Councils, Inter-Academy Partnership, and the Global Funding Agency Network, and the final important point is the network of the Chief Science Advisor, including Vaughan, as Vaughan mentioned. So the, from the business actors here is important, industries, physics. Particularly, I mentioned the World Business Council on Sustainable Development and the Global Compact has been playing important role. So in conclusion, we need coordinate and building system of systems beyond the boundaries, such as scientific discipline, traditional discipline, physics, chemistry, and the discipline, biosciences. Beyond the boundaries, scientific disciplines, programs, organizations, gender, generations, and national borders in order to address SDGs inclusively and sustainably. That's my remarks. Thank you.
On?
Well, thank you, Bill. I really want to thank Bill Colglazier for inviting me to participate in this panel, and AAAS for being an institution that has been very relevant to the mission of our embassy in science diplomacy. Our very first meeting, or my very first meeting, even before I was an ambassador, a full-fledged ambassador here in Washington, I had just arrived in early September of 2014, and before I even stepped foot in the embassy, I was across the street here activating my gas account for the residence at Washington Gas, and I'm looking out the window and I saw AAAS. I thought, well, that's as good of a place to start our diplomatic engagement in Washington as any. And so I walked across the street in my blue jeans, so much for protocol, and asked the front the lady at the front desk if I could talk with the person in charge of international relations. And she put me in touch with Tom, and he set up our first meeting between Tom, Von Turekian, and myself at the embassy. So this was before I even presented credentials at the White House. So thank you, AAAS. And we haven't stopped since. At the Embassy of Costa Rica, we have probably on average at least one science and technology related meeting every single day. is usually focused on some topic. It could be illegal fishing, it could be a natural disaster, it could be Zika, it could be, you know, a number of areas. But we always look at what is the science component that can be applied to this problem or this challenge or this program. And I think that's very relevant in this panel, in that we're talking about the Sustainable Development Goals and applying science to these goals. I'd like to start out by making the obvious point, and that is that none of these goals are going to simply happen without a very sustained, focused effort with the appropriate policy. So if we just let things slide, we won't achieve those goals. And then the next point, which is the whole point of this panel, is, okay, so what is the role of science? And science definitely has a role to play and should be the driving force for a lot of these goals. And that you could call as a self-evident truth, just as in the Declaration of Independence of the U.S. It says that all men are created equal and have a right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, and doesn't get into whether that's worthwhile or whether that's really a right. It's just self-evident. Well, the need to apply science to these goals is self-evident, because the alternative would be we don't apply science, so we apply some policy, but it's not necessarily grounded in evidence or in truth. And when we talk about science, it's not that we have to go to the lab or people in white lab coats have to be at the table designing policy. But it's really the scientific thought process. And is that thought process brought to bear in designing the policies and the programs and the appropriate level of funding that will be necessary to achieve all of these goals by the stated date? And that's where I think the role of science really has to bear on this. We are in Costa Rica engaging the science community at different levels. We obviously have the local science community, and everyone has their area of focus. It might be marine scientists, or it might be water, it might be food production, public health, and so forth. But we also have the broader scientific community, and within that broader global scientific community is our diaspora, our scientific diaspora. So Costa Rican scientists that are in their fields but living abroad. And most of them are here in the United States. So that is an important part of our engagement at the embassy. We have a lot of events, we attend a lot of meetings. Later this year, we're going to have a science open house at the embassy. We're going to invite our diaspora in science and technology to the embassy for a couple of days of thinking on how to promote science and technology in Costa Rica, and particularly in achieving some of these goals. There's obviously not time to go into what we're doing in every one of these areas, but any time we see an opportunity for applying science to one of these areas, we jump on it. I recall watching an HBO special, Vice, and they were interviewing Carl June on the promise of immunotherapy for cancer treatment. And we thought, well, you know, we definitely should go meet with Carl June. And so we went up to UPenn. He couldn't, he wasn't there that day. We knew that going up, but we were met by the leadership of the med school there, and we ended up signing an MOU between UPenn Med School and our Ministry of Health in Costa Rica. And we've since done that with other universities as well. This is just one area as an example, focused on health It could be cancer, it could be the Zika outbreak or other areas, but we're always on the outlook for opportunities where our embassy can play a role in identifying a potential collaborator in the scientific community that can bring that expertise in collaboration with Costa Rica to achieve one of these goals. And so I would just like to say that it's been a very rewarding and rich agenda, this agenda of science diplomacy, which hadn't really been practiced before in our embassy. But two and a half years into formally launching sort of our science diplomacy program, we find ourselves busier than ever in this area. And I certainly appreciate the role that AAAS has played in being a partner in this. Seems like we're on the circuit now with a lot of these panels. We were just in Arizona. Before that we were in Boston. But it really does advance the cause. And so, you know, I don't want to go on because I know time is limited, but I look forward to the Q&A session. Thank you.
So thank you, Bill and Tom, for the opportunity to be here today, and to my fellow panelists for inspiring words that we've heard so far. I'm going to try to be quite brief in favor of time for Q&A, but I do want to cover a couple of high-level notes and then a couple of specific topics. As Rush said during his opening remarks today, we have a lot of work to do to let the public, to let our elected representatives know what the SDGs are all about, and even that they exist. And as I speak to groups around the country, I'm often asked, well, just what is sustainability and how does it differ from resilience? Resilience being another term that that people often hear. So probably everybody in this room knows that sustainability means meeting the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. That's a simple concept that I think most members of the public can latch onto, but we need to spread that word far more widely. As we get on with pursuit of science and technology that supports the SDGs. With respect to resilience, I like to tell people that, well, if you're gonna be sustainable in the long term, you need to be resilient to short-term perturbations. And that too seems to get traction. So there's a time scale separation between sustainability and resilience. The same developments in science, technology, and innovation will have benefits in both of those spaces, but there is a distinction, and I think it's useful for the public to understand. So at the national academies, and it is plural, sciences, engineering, and medicine, we view the SDGs as calling on all three of those arenas. So we want to bring the full wherewithal of the organization to bear. And as we focus on those long-term sustainability issues, and just as we saw in the first slide a few minutes ago, I like to think of things over 50-year time spans. It's approximately my lifetime. If you're a recent graduate, it's only twice your lifetime. So 50 years is a time scale that people can latch onto. And I'll give you just a few motivational facts and figures. In the last 50 years, world per capita energy consumption is up by 55% per capita. And there are a lot more of us capitas living on Earth. Human population is up by 133% in the same 50 years. So the demands that we're placing on natural resources and on the systems that deliver the things we need to live are increasing rapidly. Water withdrawal is up more than 100% during that time, and about 70% of water use is for agriculture, and much of that, of course, is directed towards supplying our nutritional needs. I could talk about land degradation, deforestation, a whole host of other things, but the point being that we have rapidly increasing demands, and meeting those demands now and going forward requires a lot of forward thinking in science, technology, and innovation. As Vaughan indicated, in some cases it could be innovative scale up of existing capability, but I think a lot of our SDGs are going to require brand new science and brand new technological developments. So at the National Academies, my predecessors got into the sustainability business about 20 years ago in the mid-90s. In 1999, they published what's now regarded as a seminal report entitled Our Common Journey, A Transition Towards Sustainability. And in it, there were some recommendations and guidance for how our science and technology should develop, things that needed to be done over time scales of a couple of generations. Well, here we are now, more than 15 years later, we're well into that first generation, so we're considering where we are, what needs to be done in new arenas that weren't considered before. And to help us provide that sort of advice and guidance to government, the private sector, and to the public, we have as a centerpiece of our sustainability program a roundtable populated by representatives from government agencies, from academia, from the private sector, and from the nonprofit world. And I'm pleased to say that both Bill and Vaughan serve on that roundtable, so we have great advice coming into the academies to help us develop guidance for people outside of our organization. Over the last decade or so, our program has focused mainly on four areas. Energy and water, global food security, urban sustainability issues, and the fourth category is what I think of as nationally focused activities, either national in the whole of government sense or national in the geographic sense. And now teeing off of that, our roundtable has recently gone through an exercise to identify new general areas of activity. We've prioritized those, and we're soon to announce new focus areas in sustainable manufacturing, ocean issues, SDG number 8 in particular, jobs in the economy, but in the greater sense, all of the SDGs. And we'll also have kind of a renewal or refurbishment of our food security focus. So we hope to be bringing good advice in those arenas in the near future. Regarding the 17 goals and the 169 targets and the 304 associated indicators, some of them are quite mature, others not so much. I'll highlight just the targets associated with the oceans goal. Now, some of you may know that that oceans didn't appear in the Millennium Development Goals. They do now exist in the Sustainable Development Goals. So you might expect that arena is not quite as mature, and indeed, there's quite a lot of development that needs to be done there to identify really targets on which states, nations, corporations, et cetera, can really execute. So bringing our goals and the targets that underpin them to a functional level of maturity remains a challenge for many of the goals, oceans being just one. Let me quickly just point to a recent development in the private sector that I think you may find useful. The Business and Sustainable Development Commission has been looking into impact on business of achieving the 17 goals. Their report entitled Better Business, Better World was just published in January. It offers a very positive statement on setting business strategy, including for science, technology, and innovation, and transforming markets in line with the 17 goals. The authors argue that by achieving the SDGs, that up to $12 trillion of market opportunities exist. So this is not something that people have to go out with a purely altruistic mode. There's money to be made in this arena, and I'm pleased to see that that corporations around the world are beginning to engage. The particular arenas that that the report focused on are food and agriculture, cities, energy and materials, and health and well-being. And they looked just at the 60 largest markets around the world, so the figure is likely to be larger than the 12 trillion that they were able to document. So on that hopeful business-oriented note, I think I'll stop and thank you for your attention.
Well, we have maybe 10 minutes before the coffee break. And what I think we'll do is maybe we can take four questions, but not to have the answers. Four questions will all come out, and then in the last 2 minutes for each of the speakers, they can answer whatever question they want or not answer any of them at all. So you might be thinking about that. I just might mention two things. I'm very glad that Jerry mentioned Better Business, Better World, which I think is an impressive report. Sitting on the member of the Sustainability Roundtable at the Academy, I think some of the most interesting and innovative things have come actually from the corporate members. Román also mentioned, well, what is the role of science related to the SDGs? A number of us were at the last 2 days at the AAAS Science Policy Forum, and the conversation was very much about what is the scientific evidence on issues. And I think what the SDGs have given us, they have told us for what purpose. So the purpose represented by the 17 SDGs, so it's not only bringing the scientific evidence about the challenges, but also, as Román indicated, how science can actually help advising on the strategies, the actions, the plans that are taking, trying to make progress. And I think you saw from Hana's talk that some societies are taking a very impressive, very sophisticated, not only whole of government, but whole of society approach, trying to think through the implications of the SDGs for their society. Japan is, I was really pleased to hear how to the extent to which the science and technology agencies really are rolling up their sleeves in Japan and becoming part of the process to how Japan can contribute not only within the country, but also all of its programs dealing with other countries. And Vaughan, I think in his role not only in the State Department, but his role at the UN with a multi-stakeholder forum on science, technology, innovation, I think is, last year was, I think, a success, and I think it's going to even be a more successful and more innovative approach with the forum that's coming up in May. So anyway, well, at least we have two questions. If you could make your question relatively brief, both of you, and then we'll give the panelists 2 minutes each to respond.
Thank you, and thank you to the panel for emphasizing the major functions of the Sustainable Development Goals and the processes of diplomacy that support those and promote them. I would like to add an asterisk to this and ask the panel, anyone who'd like to respond to it. At the annual meeting last year, I had the honor of being elevated to fellow of the AAAS for contributions to scientific integrity. And it's in that light that I make the following observation, and that is there are integrity issues throughout this process, both the quality of the science, where we've heard a lot of current science is not reproducible and therefore is of questionable value, and then the uses of science where we have very good science but very questionable uses, such as tremendous overproduction of OxyContin, leading to potential opioid epidemics. Just as quality control is not the main focus of production of goods or services, so scientific integrity is a form of quality control, and it's not the primary emphasis of sustainable development. But do you tend to agree that concern about scientific integrity ought to be a consideration built in as a quality control item to efforts at sustainable development?
Thank you. Next, if you want to ask your question too.
Yeah, thank you so much for the panel. My name is Alejandro de la Puente. My question is for Román. I congratulate you for your efforts, and I think this is something that most Latin American countries should be thinking about. What would be one advice that you will give other countries in South and Latin America, Central America and the Caribbean, to start developing sort of a framework of science and technology advice to policymakers, specifically in ministries such as the ones that look into the environment, health, education, et cetera. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll also ask one question for the panelists. What do you think is the biggest obstacle in your country or in your region in terms of making progress on the SDGs and applying science, technology, innovation? I think in my own country, in the U.S., now with the recent changes here in our, it's going to be a challenge even with, if the Democrats have stayed in the power and might have a focus on the SDGs, maybe a bigger challenge now. So in some sense, we may have to rely an awful lot on our foreign colleagues, as well as the non-governmental science and technology agencies in the U.S. to kind of pick up the ball and carry the message forward, at least for the next couple of years. So I certainly see that as one of the obstacles in the U.S., but I'd be interested, as each of our panelists think about their own country and their own region, what do they see? So I'll turn it over to them. Maybe we'll start out from this end and just move down. So Professor Arimoto, if you'd like to go first.
So my last comment is we should declare the science for SDGs is the new social contract in the 21st century, the value of science, I think. So the second one is I stress the importance of having the robust science advice systems interface of the science and international politics in order to achieve the SDG goals. And third one is we need redesign R&D funding and evaluation systems from traditional discipline-based peer review to multidisciplinary and solution-oriented approach. This is very challenging. Some gentleman mentioned stress the keeping scientific integrity and the scientific quality control. And last one is I do hope SDG could be a help or symbol for citizens and young people to understand what is science, what is modern science, and why science is so important to the society, nature, and us. That's my comment. Thank you.
Thank you. Go on.
Thank you, and thank you for the questions. I'll sort of frame it broadly in that question on integrity and speak to just a few issues. One is, I think that, and it also gets maybe to even the challenge. I think one of the big challenges is that we really need to have the right institutional frameworks and the right institutional setups to be able to even implement. And then, there is a goal. There's a goal for that. There's sort of an app for that, right? The goal for that is SDG 16. And I think that one of the things that's really important when we think about going forward, it's how do we make sure that we have accountable institutions? And accountable institutions include the scientific and engineering community as well. And so that's a big challenge to making sure that we're implementing not only the specific goal, but the broader set of goals overall. That accountable institutions and strong institutions are central to this. Second, and it gets a little bit to what my colleague Arimoto-san is saying, is that I think we need to think about this from the standpoint of how do we set up the right systems for even evaluating what the science and technology is. And being able to put those in place not only at the national level, but also at the regional and global level. And I know there's a lot of efforts being put into that. And so just as a whole, making sure that countries are more equipped to be able to even evaluate the technologies that are potentially applicable to scaling up or to putting into the market in order to be able to actually have a better chance of actually meeting many of these goals. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, and big thanks to our fellow panelists for truly, truly inspiring interventions. I think you summed it up best, Professor Colglazier. I think it's really, there's a strong case really to rethink sort of a whole of society approach into what we're doing here. So and this ambitious agenda that is, we call Agenda 2030, including the Sustainable Development Goals and the Paris Agreement. And from our experience, you need to rethink institutions, both as just mentioned, but also how we, sort of the perspective with which we see solutions. So using a science sort of mindset and the process used technically or normally in science communities towards evidence-based policymaking is really, really essential. So some of the, I guess, three main areas that I would focus on, particularly for the region. First one being in our approach to gender empowerment. If you take a science mindset to this and look at the evidence, it's not so much about empowering women, but about empowering societies through women. If we look at infrastructure, we need to rethink, well, it's not just anymore about roads and transport kind of thing. We also look at sort of internet, access to basic internet as basic infrastructure that we need to start building into our policies. And then when looking at good governance, we need to find ways to utilize STI as a powerful tool to tackle root causes of extremism by really enhancing societal participation, encouraging tolerance, moderation, and economic opportunities. So I think to end on a positive note, I think the Better Business, Better World report gives us a lot of hope in the $12 trillion and counting. And I would also like to note that it also mentions 330 million jobs that are created really by the achievement of the SDGs. So we look forward to seeing what that looks like. And thank you all for having me here.
Thank you. Jerry.
So I would just add that on the issue of scientific integrity and reproducibility, I don't think the problems are pervasive. There's a lot of good work done with high degrees of integrity and quite good reproducibility. There are, of course, a number of cases that we've read about over the last two or three years, for instance, in the pharmaceutical industry, where there have been difficulties. Vaughan's remark about the institutional focus is really, really spot on. But I don't think that it's as widespread as the rhetoric seems to indicate. The second point I would make in that arena is that social sciences are really hard. Reproducibility on studies of us humans is, you know, by its nature difficult. So that's a challenge that needs to be met. And then thirdly, natural systems are really hard to study in a reproducible way. I grew up as an oceanographer, and I spent more than a year of my life at sea taking measurements of various things. And I know that if I went back to the same spot a week later, or a month later, or a year later, things would have changed. It's just the nature of such systems. So reproducibility really is a difficult concept to achieve in that arena. And as I think about all of these things, all of the facets of integrity and reproducibility across the suite of the 17 SDGs, I think we really do have to focus on a systems approach. I have a friend at the National Academies who has told me that, well, if we only focus on the health goal, everything else will fall in place. A good friend at IASA in Vienna, Wolfgang Lutz, will tell you that if you just focus on the education goal, everything else will fall into place. Life is not that simple. We need a systems approach, and with that, a system to assure that integrity is built in and that the fact that results do come with a high degree of integrity needs to be communicated to the public and to policymakers so that they can take on board what we have to offer.
Thank you. Román.
I don't want to belabor too much on the integrity issue, but it is fundamental. I mean, if there isn't integrity, there's nothing. And so the peer review system has to work. It is working overall. And that has to be just very robust in publishing scientific research. But Bill, you mentioned one of the what are the big challenges of implementing science related projects or guidance on projects. And in a country like Costa Rica, that's relatively small. You know, our population is less than 5 million. Some time ago, I asked how many chemists have we graduated in Costa Rica in our history, and it was less than 700. Mm-hmm. And that includes all the dead chemists and the retired chemists and the chemists that are ambassadors or anything. So the available human talent is limited. And so if you are very specialized in a field, that peer review, going back to integrity, has to be international. We don't have the base inside Costa Rica for that to happen, and if so, that means obviously science has to be international, and that goes across the board, whether it's reviewing patents or so many different issues. But going to Alejandro's question as to what advice would I have for countries, especially in Latin America, to implement science and technology policy? I would say overall is just trying to create spaces within the state, within the government, for scientists. They can have leadership roles. They could have advisory roles. But they should permeate the system. I mean, I'm very impressed with what you find here in the U.S. Vaughan, you were mentioning 250 PhDs at the State Department. I mean, any tech company would love to have 250 PhDs. And here's a State Department that has, they're not all in science, but they are all in science? Okay, so even better. So that's very impressive. Obviously, a country like Costa Rica, if we put 250 PhDs, we'd run out of PhDs into anything. But we can try to leverage science wherever possible. In our diplomatic corps, we only have 55 embassies, so 55 ambassadors, and two of us are PhD scientists. So percentage-wise, that's very high for us. But I would say just create those spaces and maybe some form of a body that's apolitical that can transcend administrations, that can hopefully advise the administration, whoever that may be, on science and technology policy.
Yeah, and also one last thought before I turn it over to Tom to close this session. Another reason why I think the SDGs are a great opportunity for the science community, and where a lot of work is needed from the science community, the overall goal is to accomplish all 17. And there are lots of synergies, and in some cases there are trade-offs and conflicts. So I think the role of the science technology community, looking at how we, as Jerry said, the systems analysis, how we maximize the synergies and minimize the trade-offs and conflicts. Well, thank you all. It's been a great session. I'll turn it over to Tom.